According to the Chicago Board Option Exchange, there were approximately 1.1 billion option contracts sold via its system in 2016. That's a lot of contracts. But you may be wondering why so many people invest in this derivative investment rather than the underlying security that its value is based off of. Well, options don't simply copy a stock's return. Their payoff follows a more complex pattern. And if used properly, they can fundamentally change your investments. How? We'll find out in today's Plain Bagel. Derivatives are pretty self-explanatory in how they work. They are a group of investments that derive their value from an underlying security or rate. You can look at them as a sort of bet between two investors over which direction a certain investment is going to move. And as with most bets, one investor ends up paying the other based on how things turn out. Options, like the broader derivatives category, are also pretty self-explanatory and work in a similar manner to the derivative analogy. You see, an option is a security sold from one investor to another that represents an agreement between the two parties. The buyer of the option pays a premium to the option writer, or the person selling the derivative. In exchange for the payment, the buyer is given the right, aka the option, to buy or sell a specified investment from or to the other party at a predetermined price at some point in the future. In other words, the seller promises the buyer that so long as the option is valid, they will take the other side of a future buyer sell at a specified stock price for the underlying security, should the option holder choose to do so. A right to buy a share from the option writer is known as a call, and an option to sell a share is called a put. Call options are a sort of bet that a stock's price will increase, whereas put options bet that a stock's price will fall. And the profitability of each option will depend on the difference between the option's strike price, the agreed upon transaction price, and the market price of the underlying stock at the option's expiration. For example, if a stock's price rises to $50, but you have a call option with a strike price of $40, well, you can make $10 by exercising your option and buying the stock at $40. Simple enough, right? But there's an important nuance to recognize here regarding when you can actually use an option. You see, options sometimes have different rules over their timing. American options, for example, allow the holder to buy or sell the underlying share any time until their expiration date has passed, whereas European options can only carry out the trade on the expiration date itself. All right, so that's a quick and dirty on how options work. But you may be wondering how that's any different from buying or shorting a stock. After all, if you're betting the stock's price will increase, why not just purchase the underlying asset instead of the option? Well, don't be fooled. Options provide a very different risk-return trade-off to the underlying stock. One of the best ways to understand this difference is to visualize their returns. For example, let's say that you were looking at buying a stock of Plain Bagel Corp. A great company, I hear, but I'm not supposed to give my opinion. If you buy the share, we can graph how your total return will be affected by movement in the stock's price. And, well, that's pretty boring. But it makes sense. Because you own the stock, any dollar increase in the stock's price will be a dollar added to your return. The slope crosses the x-axis at the price you paid for the stock, which we'll say is $30, meaning that if the price doesn't change, well, you make $0. Great, so now let's look at a call for a Plain Bagel share with the following stats. If we plot the return, it looks a bit more interesting. As you can see, the two have similar upside potential, though the $2 premium you pay for the option brings it slightly below the shares line. This upside happens when the stock's price falls above the option's strike price, aka when the call is in the money. Because in this area, you can buy the stock for the lower strike price and theoretically sell it at the higher market price. But look at the downside risk, or lack thereof, with the security. You'll notice that if the market price of the stock falls below the strike price, aka when your call is out of the money, the most you can lose is the premium you paid for the call. This is because an investor doesn't need to exercise an option if doing so would not be profitable. If the stock's price falls, you can just let the option expire. Puts work in a similar manner, but since they entail the right to sell a security, the graph is actually flipped. If a stock's price falls below the strike price, you could buy a share at the lower market price and exercise the put to sell the share at the higher strike price, making a profit while, again, limiting your downside risk to just $2. As you can see, options can be used as a sort of insurance, limiting downside risk while still allowing you to capitalize on a stock's expected movement. Pretty cool, isn't it? But what we've covered is truly just the tip of the iceberg. While options can help hedge risk, you can use them to increase the risk of your holdings as well. How? Well, as mentioned, options can be written between two investors. And while we've talked about buying or going long with options, you can actually sell or short them too. That's right, you can actually be the other investor in this situation, writing puts and calls for different securities. Why'd we do that? Well, if you believe a stock's price will remain relatively stable or that it will move in a certain direction, you can sell the option that you believe will not be exercised and receive the premium upfront for the position. If the option goes unused, well, you make it out with a small return. If you're wondering what this looks like graphically, it's simple enough to plot since you take the put and call option graphs and, well, invert them. But here's the catch with selling options. You can see that you've now limited your upside and accepted a larger downside. This is a really important point to highlight. Writing options exposes you to more risk than buying them. In particular, when it comes to selling call options, you'll see that you technically have the potential to lose an infinite amount of money. This is because a stock's price could technically increase to infinity. So if you sell a call for a stock that later increases in price by, say, 400%, well, you'd be stuck paying the expensive price and selling the stock at the lower strike price to the option holder. But you may exclaim, I figured it out, Richard. What if you sell a call option and buy the share right away to avoid paying the future market price? Great point, worthy adversary. That is what's known as a covered call. And the graph for it looks like this. And congratulations, you've unlocked your next level of option abilities. Because once you start combining different security positions with their puts and calls, well, my friends, you enter a world of many possibilities. Combining puts, calls, and underlying shares allows you to dramatically alter the return characteristics of your holdings. A number of these combinations are used regularly within the investment community and have been given names that summarize what their return pattern looks like. If you're feeling bullish about a position, why not try taking advantage of it via a bull spread? Or if you're more worried about a stock's future, the bear spread could allow you to capitalize on a downward shift. Feeling creative? Why not check out the butterfly spread, which profits if a stock price remains stable. And if that's not your cup of tea, why not try this straight line one? Seriously, this is one of the ones you can do. But I digress. Clearly, options open the door to many possibilities. But before you jump down the rabbit hole of perpetually altering the traits of your holdings, you need to understand some very important points. While options have a lot of the same positives of insurance, they have similar cons as well. With insurance, whether it be automobile, health, or life insurance, you are only covered for as long as you make regular premium payments. And if you stop paying the amount, you lose your coverage. Additionally, the higher risk you are of getting into a car accident, falling ill, or, well, dying, the higher premium you have to pay for the policy. Options follow these same two principles. Because options are temporary securities with expiration dates, the premium you pay for them only insures your position for a certain period of time, meaning that if you want to extend the coverage of, say, a protective put, you'll have to continually purchase new options to keep the hedge, paying premiums all the while. Secondly, there are a number of factors that impact how much an option sells for, which I'll deal with in the description down below, but to summarize them, the more likely you are to exercise an option, the more expensive it will be. If you happen to find a call option with a strike price below the current market price, for example, you can bet that the premium you pay for it will more than offset any profit you'd make from immediately exercising the right. So there's no free lunch when it comes to using options, and their risk-return characteristics are much more complicated than simply buying a share. Because of this, they aren't really appropriate for investors who only have a base level understanding of how they work. But if you're comfortable with the idea of buying and selling options, how do you go about doing so? Well, much like stocks, options can be bought or sold via exchanges, such as the Chicago Board Options Exchange, or CBOE. These exchanges can be accessed via brokerages, though you'll have to check to make sure your broker provides you access to the derivatives market. Options are also similar to bonds in that you can sell them before they've reached their expiration if you want to exit the position prematurely. And if you want to cash out without actually trading the underlying share, you can carry out what's called an offsetting trade, where you take the opposite position in an identical call or put security, which causes the two to cancel each other out. So options are a really neat way to modify risk exposure, but there's no fast money to be made here. It's a complex field that requires a lot of attention. If you're a first-time investor, it may be best to start with more rudimentary securities before diving into derivatives. That being said, if you take the time to understand options and their risks, well, as we've demonstrated, you can do a lot of cool stuff. But with that said, we're out of time. If you like this video, please hit the like button. And if you like what we're doing here, please subscribe. Hit the bell icon to make sure you get notifications about future videos. If you have any feedback or topics you'd like us to cover in future videos, leave a comment down below. For The Plain Bagel, my name is Richard Coffin. Thanks for joining me today.